No.
Good morning, y'all.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the May Fulton County Republican Party breakfast. We are delighted to have y'all here, and I see a lot of new faces. I'm Angelyn Dionysatos. This is Ryan Williams. We are your hosts, and we're going to get started right away. So I would like to ask a very special friend of ours, Bob Schwall. He's the chairman emeritus of the Fulton GOP and one of our founding members, and he's going to lead us in prayer this morning.
Our Father, we boldly come before your presence today, confessing that you are God and our help cometh from you. We seek that help from you today. We ask you to bless us together, bless this part in the principles for which we stand and what we are trying to achieve in this country. God bless America. We pray, Father, that you will watch over your children throughout the world. We know that they're being persecuted everywhere. We pray that we'll stand strong and we will continue to look to you for favors every day. All these blessings we ask in Christ's name.
Bob, we have two American flags in the place, but this is going to be our main flag. And I've got Michael Fitzgerald. If you don't know Michael, he's the chairman of this great party. And please call him Michael.
Isn't she the perfect height?
We're missing our base.
She couldn't touch the ceiling if she had to. Veterans, please raise your hand. Thank you. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, liberty and justice for all.
Play ball. Thank you, Mike. Sometimes we improvise around here. We are happy to be here at a new location in Sandy Springs, which is my hometown, so I think this is the best city in Fulton County in Georgia and in the world. And we're delighted this morning to have our mayor with us. He's going to let you all know what's going on with the city, with the new developments across the street for City Hall and Mercedes and lots of other great stuff. So will you all please join me in welcoming Rusty Paul.
And I second Angelyn's motion that this is the greatest city in Fulton County right now. Some of you, Betty Price, a few others, may have a slightly different opinion, but it's great to be in a city in Sandy Springs. You know, it took us 35 years to make it happen. And just a couple of weeks ago, we lost our founding mother, Eva Galambos, and it was a real, sad occasion, but we took that opportunity to celebrate all that she had done for this community over her lifetime. I mean, if you look at Sandy Springs and you see anything going on here, she had her fingerprints on it at some point in the past. And of course, many of us will go this afternoon and say goodbye to a dear friend, Harry Geisinger, who is a true pioneer. I moved to Georgia in 1974, and Harry was already in the middle of running for governor at that time. And that was, I was just telling John Padgett that my very first Republican convention was in the old Marriott, which is now the Sheraton downtown. We met, and Bob, the room was about a little bit larger than this, and I'm not exaggerating that I told the story. I was sitting in the back, and in the middle of the convention, the waiter comes down, Trey right here, towel over his, draped over his arm, walks right down the middle aisle with three Bloody Marys and delivers them to the front. So that was the kind of, you know, the mindset of the Republican Party at the time. It was more of a country club kind of environment. You had to be a little off to be a Republican at that time, too. Normal people weren't Republicans because normal people ran as Democrats because they thought they could get elected. But we'd show up, we'd have 300 people at the precinct caucuses because the precinct chairman's job was about the only thing that a Republican could win at that time. My, how things have changed over the last 20 years, and John says he's expecting over 2,500 people in Athens for the convention, and probably, you know, it's just amazing what has happened within our party over the last decade or so. And it was the pioneers like Harry, like Eva, like Tom Lowe, who toiled in the vineyards at the time, and it was very difficult to win, almost impossible to win. And so losing our pioneers is a sad occasion, but it's very important to remember from where we came. Well, let me get into the main. How many of you actually live in Sandy Springs?
Yay!
Wow. Right. So this is somewhat of a campaign speech. It's an exciting time in our city. We spent, as I say, over 35 years trying to create the opportunity to just simply control our thing. And so we've been in business, believe it or not. In December, we will celebrate our 10th anniversary. And it doesn't seem that long. It almost still seems like yesterday that we started. And I told folks at the time two things. One, if you look back over 10, just when you start out, you're not going to see a lot of change at the very beginning. But if you look back over 10 years, you're going to see a significant amount of change and improvement in the overall quality of life in our community. In the last 10 years, we have built over 34 miles of new sidewalks. 10 years ago, all you Sandy Springers, 10 years ago, how many of you would ask for a sidewalk? You would have asked for it, but you wouldn't have got it. And now, guess what? The biggest problem we have is now that we've built all these new sidewalks, everybody wants one. And so the biggest demand now is gone from speed humps to sidewalks. We've resurfaced over 200 miles of street. Now think, you know, the current resurfacing process for Fulton County meant that you got your street resurfaced once every 100 years. That's how much they were spending on street resurfacing. By then we're back in the mud. So we've resurfaced over 184 miles. In fact, the quality of our roads is such today, we have a scale on 1 to 100. Everything above 70 is good quality roads. So many of our roads now are in that 70 and above category that we were able to cut $1 million out of our paving program this year and put it into other projects. So our streets and roads are in better shape. Now, if you go down to Hammond right now, that one looks ugly, but we're about to shave it, and that's when the streets will get paved this year. And so we've made a tremendous amount of progress in dealing with our infrastructure and the basics of our services. Now, when you come back here sometime maybe late fall or some as you make your rounds around all the other communities in Sandy Springs or in Fulton County, This parcel across the street is going to look a lot different. This is what we call our city center project. At least that's the working title right now. We've got a group of people trying to decide whether that's going to be actually the name of this area, or we want to name it something else. But across the street will be a new city hall. We will have a new about 1,100 seat performing arts center. We will have a smaller, what we call the family theater, which will also serve as the city council chambers, but it will allow us to have these kind of functions for up to 250 people. When I gave the State of the City speech last year, right after I'd been elected, there was no place to hold it in Sandy Springs. I had to deliver the State of the City speech in Brookhaven. And I told them that was the last time that was going to happen. Even if we have to build us a place over here, which is what we're going to do. And then there's going to be a great 4-acre park in the middle of it with trees and fountains, and it's going to be a world-class facility. That's been the power. I was actually with some folks this week who had kind of, you know, when we started this municipalization process, there were a lot of folks who thought that, well, that's going to be the death of regionalism, that we want to be able to come together in ways that will allow us to do the big projects and affect things on a regional basis. And what the truth of that is just the opposite. Since these cities have come together, or we've created the new cities, there has been more work done on a regional basis than was ever done before. I'll give you some examples. If you're in Buckhead, ride around, you see a fire truck, it's more likely to have a Sandy Springs logo on it than a city of Atlanta. Why is that? Well, we needed to be able to serve the south end of the city. The city of Atlanta had some extra capacity. And so they said, why don't you just lease the space from us? So we got down there and worked together for about 2 or 3 years. And then they came to us and said, look, you're doing such a great job. Why don't we do this? Why don't we sell you this station, and you go ahead and we'll do mutual aid. And so we own a city of Atlanta fire station to serve the southern end of Sandy Springs, and we also serve the north end of Buckhead. If you are in our panhandle, I know Jim and Donna Squire, they live out kind of way out there. The first liquor license we approved when I became mayor was in Norcross. I thought that was great. I thought we were just expanding our empire. But that's how far our city goes out to the Norcross mailing area. Out there, we don't have a station that really can reach the very tip end in a short period of time. So we work with Roswell. We've got a mutual aid agreement with them. If we have a response out there, they come and serve that area for us. So that we have more cooperation actually going on than we've ever had. Dunwoody and Brookhaven and Sandy Springs and Johns Creek and some other cities that I can't think of right off the top of my head. I think maybe Roswell's involved. We just put together a brand new public safety network. If you were a police officer riding around in many of our cities, you had dead spots. And the worst thing that can happen to a police officer is that you can't communicate. Well, we had too many dead spots. So we invested and just opened in the last couple of weeks a brand new digital system that allows people all over, the public safety personnel all over the North Fulton area to communicate with each other. Even in buildings that oftentimes couldn't communicate. Dick Anderson, the new county manager for Fulton County, was out. We did a windshield tour of Sandy Springs. And we were talking about 911. We have a joint 911 program here with Johns Creek, Dunwoody, Brookhaven, and Sandy Springs. And the county is actually, they've got to make a choice. They can go invest in several million dollars of new technology and equipment at the county level, or they can join us. What's turned out is these municipalities have become what I call Lego blocks of service delivery. We can attach them where it makes sense on regional type projects like public safety, transportation, so on. But if it's just a local issue, we can deal with it and deal with it much more effectively and deal with it much faster than you could under the bureaucratic process of Fulton County. And so even the most hardened skeptics about the municipalization process are coming around and saying, hey, it really is not as bad as we thought, and actually the truth is things are working better. Because the government that's, you know, even some of my Republican friends would say, well, you're just creating more government. Well, no, actually what we're doing is creating more responsive government, because the government, as we Republicans all know, that is closest to the people is always the best form of government. And if you're in Fulton County, even, and I think we've got a commission now that's beginning to try and work with people rather than fight with people. But even in that kind of situation, county governments are not really structured in a way that they got to treat everybody pretty much the same, which drives service levels down to the lowest common denominator, which is what our frustration was all about all along. And so with the municipalization of Fulton County, we've got more responsive government, we've moved government closer to the people, and I can tell you that people take advantage of it. About a week or so ago, my wife sent me to the local Publix to go pick up something for dinner. Should have been a 10-minute trip. I got back an hour and 15 minutes later, and I was faced with a bunch of hungry people and angry people at my house, because as I walked through the supermarket, people were stopping and talking to me about their concerns, about their problems, about whatever issues they were upset about, or just simply say, hey, look, things are going great. We love what's going on in Sandy Springs right now. And so, you know, oftentimes I can't do a lot about everybody, I can't solve everybody's problem. But just simply the fact that they can see me at church, see me in the grocery store, see me here, and talk to me about their problems. And sometimes I can fix them and sometimes I can't. at least they've got that sounding board. They know they've been heard, they know they've been listened to, and if there's somebody out there who's really trying to do something about it. Because I know that I'm going to run into them in the grocery store again, and they're going to ask me. So I need to have an answer about what it is we've tried to do to solve their problems. So in Sandy Springs, we got, it's just an amazing place, amazing things going on here with our with the investments that we're making in our infrastructure, stormwater, and our city center. John, I hope that one day we might be able, probably not the state convention there, but we'll maybe have some major party events where we can seat about, well, we could probably handle 1,500, 2,000 or so over there, not in one seating, but if we wanted to do some training or other things, ideal location. And it's been done largely by Republicans. It's our responsive approach to government. We're showing people that we can govern, that we can solve problems at a local level. And we're getting a lot of attention in that process. As you know, we use, and I'm going to wrap this up and give you a chance to answer questions, because now you got other people who want to earn some oxygen this morning. We have people from all over the world come into Sandy Springs to study our unique form of service delivery. You know, we privatized all of our services except for public safety, fire, police, and we probably could have done that. We now know that there are former military organizations that have now created businesses to do that. We could probably have outsourced our public safety at the same time. We just didn't know it at the time. I went right after I was elected last year. I went to a U.S. Conference of Mayors, and I wish they'd put me on the program because I had to give about 15 or 20 different presentations about our service delivery strategy and model. Because there was a tremendous amount of interest in how you use private sector to deliver services. Most municipalities in the country are short of resources, we've all heard, well, we try to run our city, our county, our state like a business. And I had one mayor tell me, well, we run our city like a business. I said, well, that's the difference between your city and my city. And I could see that he was puzzled by that response. I said, well, the difference is, you try to run your city like a business, we have a business that runs our city. And the light bulb went on. Because we all talk about the private, you know, how we can use the private sector to get things done more effectively and efficiently. But in government, there is no profit motive in the main under the normal structures that we have. But you go to the kind of service delivery model that our new cities are utilizing, and people are, we're putting the power, the innovation of the private sector into solving local problems, and it's working. It truly is working. I had a reporter from Al Jazeera came to town, and nobody wanted to talk to him. I thought, bring him. And so the reporter asked me, said, Mr. Paul, your contractors are making a profit. Doesn't that bother you? Could you use that money to provide more services? I said, well, let me put it this way. I want those contractors to make a good profit. Because if they're making a good profit, they want to hold on to that contract. And they know that to be able to hold on to that contract, they got to provide a higher level of service to be able to be considered when that contract comes up for rebid. And oh, by the way, we saved $7 million in our operating costs the last time we rebid the contract. So we're getting higher levels of service at lower rates. And so I said, those folks know that if they want to hold on to that contract, they got to make our constituents happy. Well, let me, as political people, we were talking about the polls. What's the matter with the polls? Why they're not accurate? We just saw that happen. Same thing happened in Britain. Well, the best poll I know of is an election. And the mayoral candidate and the city council, the mayoral candidates who've been most identified with our service delivery model have won with over 80% of the vote in every election. That's a high degree of satisfaction in my world, where 55% is considered a landslide. So we have, this process is working. The private sector can, if you harness it right and use it properly, the private sector will drive costs down and will also raise the level of the quality of your services. Well, it's been my pleasure. I want you to thank those of you who live in Sandy Springs for coming out. I really want to thank those of you who don't live in Sandy Springs for coming out. Stick around, spend some money, and enjoy the day. I'll answer a couple of questions and then we'll turn it over.
Preston, do we want to do all the questions at the end?
You've talked to
me what makes sense.
Well, you got other speakers, so let me.
Okay.
You talked a lot about infrastructure and roads and all that. I would like to know, being the mayor, how the new gas tax is going to affect your revenues in your city.
It's probably a slight wash for us. I mean, it changes. Early on, the bill had a real negative impact. We estimated it would cost about $1 million in sales tax revenue to the city. As it ultimately came out, probably is going to be a wash for us. But one of the things it will do is allow us to use more in-state dollars for projects. And why is that important? Well, I'll give an example. Right over here,
you don't have to federal, match the federal. That's what you're saying.
Well, the federal, we want to widen the road over here. And if we were to use our own resources and our state resources, we could do it in about 3 years. That project is going to be funded with federal funds, and they told us from the time we started till we began construction would be 10 years because of the red tape, the regulations, and everything that the administration has put on transportation funds. We built 146,000 miles of interstate highway between 1956 and 1970. You can't build a mile of it in that time today because of the growth of regulations at the federal level and the strings attached to that money. So we got to get out of that business and get back into using our own local funds so that we can get these transportation projects delivered on a faster process.
So back to my point, the new gas tax is not going to affect the local roads in Sandy Springs.
Oh yeah, it'll have a huge impact. Huge impact, because we will be able to do projects much faster.
You said it was going to be a wash. So you're
as far as the revenues affect the revenue impact on us.
Okay.
It's not going to cost us any revenue, but the more money, more in-state money we have, the faster we can turn projects around.
I understand. I got you now.
So that's the difference. Jim.
Yeah, talk about the unprecedented economic development we're seeing here. And Mercedes is just tip of the iceberg here, because there's so many other projects going on.
Yeah, we got so much going on that we're really almost worried about creating a bubble right now. But we've got a lot of things going on. Mercedes, you may want to apply for, there'll be about 400 jobs at Mercedes. They're going to be nice jobs, but the best thing, I found this out this week, every Mercedes headquarters employee gets a new Mercedes every year. I'm going to see if they need a mate. And they're coming in. We just got Amtrak, first time that they've moved outside the Northeast. They're coming here because of the technology talent that we have in with Georgia Tech, with University of Georgia, Emory, but also, you know, what's been added into the mix that we don't think about is the number of kids we've got at Clemson and Auburn, two other high-tech engineering schools. And they're beginning to farm those schools that are only 90 minutes away in either direction. So we've got an amazing talent base in the IT world here, and people are coming here to tap into it. The president of Mercedes told me this week that if you've got an Apple, an iPhone, or an iPad, he said there are about 8 million lines of code in one of those. In the average Mercedes driving down the road now, there's 150 million lines of code in that car. And so they need the technology talent that exists here in the metro Atlanta area to be able to come. And that's why we have an enormous amount of new economic development that's occurring here, and it's exciting. You know, when you have companies like Mercedes, State Farm, others that recognize the quality of our people, the talent that particularly our young college graduates have, it's amazing, and it's creating a great legacy and great opportunities in our communities. I can take one more, and then I know we've got some other things. All right, well, good. I quit. Angelyn, thank you.
new city into being. So thank you, Rusty, for all of your leadership and the work that you do carrying us forward. Well, we've got a fantastic crowd. Let me ask y'all, how many of you guys have never been to a Fulton GOP event before? Can we give these folks a hand? Thank you so much. We hope y'all will come back. I see a lot of people haven't seen in a while, too, so thank y'all. I'm going to recognize all of our party officers and elected officials. Well, some of the elected officials, I might embarrass myself if I forget somebody's name on my list. So let's just start this way, and if you're an elected official sitting at a table, just stand up and say your name. Brad, let's start.
Brad Raffensperger, 5th District, Johns Creek.
Bob Gray, Johns Creek City Council.
Joe Gray, City Council, City of Brookhaven.
Betty Frye is probably
City Council. Thank you. And our officers, we have Chairman Trey Kelly, who's our new chairman. We're excited to have him at the helm. He's going to be giving you some updates about the party soon. Cameron Fash is our first vice chair, returning first vice chair. We have Craig Kidd, our vice chairman. Charlie Wingo, who's hiding back over here, but Charlie works really hard to make new breakfast. Run very smoothly. He handles the registration. We call him Checkpoint Charlie. So if you came in here and thought you wouldn't have to pay, once you meet Charlie, you'll know we know different. Bob Buschman, I think I saw him over in the back there. And am I leaving out any other Fulton GOP offices? We have Ashford Schwall. Your name is even on my list. I knew I would embarrass myself if I tried to call you. Ashford is our vice chairman for membership. And so if you're not a member or...
See me to sign up. Now.
And then, where is Suzi Voyles? Suzi is our executive director. She puts the whole thing together. She has worked very hard to play with Suzi. And we have a couple of special guests. We have Miss Abbie Frye, who's the chairman. She didn't know I was going to recognize her. She's the chairman of the UGA College Republican. Abbie, will you stand up? But you came over here to Sandy Springs, so we appreciate that, and go dogs. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Trey, and he's going to tell you all a little bit about what we're doing here tomorrow.
Right, thank you, Angelyn. Thank you all for being here this morning. This is exciting. This is what I would describe maybe a small representation of trying to do some new things and new places to bring out new people. I'd like to thank, of course, Mayor Paul for having us this morning, all the leadership that he's provided us here in Fulton County and Sandy Springs. I'd like to thank Slopes Barbecue. If you have not been here by a slim chance, please come back. It's quite a treat as far as barbecue goes. Or I think I had some sausage the last time I was here too, so they did pretty good with that. But we're excited for Sandy Springs breakfast weekend in Fulton County. My wife, Carmen, and I had dinner in Sandy Springs last night. Rusty would be glad to know. But, I'd like to start with a moment of silence, if we may, for two leaders of ours that have gone on to much better places, Steve Lumbos and Jerry Geisinger. If we could just have a moment of silence. We have got some exciting things going on. I would like to first recognize two groups of speakers. We're going to do a little ask for some exercise here. If you are a member of the Fulton GOP, would you please stand? Thank you. As Ashford briefly alluded to, nothing in this world goes on without money, and politics is at the top of that. We need the support and appreciate the support. So if you are not a member, you don't have to be in Fulton County, obviously. I would encourage you to please consider going on FultonGOP.org and look at the different membership options, pick out whatever works best for you. Your support is greatly appreciated. Secondly, I would like to ask all of our House District Chairs and Precinct Chairs that are here today, please sit. The other part of politics, besides money, obviously, is the grassroots, and we cannot do what we're trying to do without leadership from our House District Chairs and Precinct Chairs, so thank you all. We have got an exciting, for anyone going to the convention next weekend, we've got an exciting reception that we're going to announce on Monday from about 5 to 7 before the chairman's dinner. So please be on the lookout for that. It's a membership reception, so another opportunity to update your membership if you have not done so already. I'm going to get out of the way and look forward to the great program that, that Angelyn, Suzi, Greg, Ashford, and Charlie have been responsible for this morning. I'd like to thank Representative Martin for coming and for his leadership on behalf of Fulton County and the state. I'd like to thank Chairman Padgett for joining us today and for all the hard work he's doing for us at the state GOP. Without further ado, Angelyn, please. Thank you all again for coming.
Party. It's at 9:30 at the Graduate, which is conveniently located next to the Red, White, and Boots Bash. So everybody in the room is welcome to come over. It'll be a great time. You get to interact with young Republicans, which you also get to interact with, more importantly than that, fellow Republicans. So if you have any questions, I'll be around, but come on out to the party, have a great time, and we'd love to see you. Thank you.
The convention is also going on at the same time as our state party convention, and we have several candidates for office. We're going to hear speeches from Jon Padgett, the incumbent chairman, who's running for re-election, and also Mr. Jack Staper, who's here on behalf of Alex Johnson. We don't have time to let all of the candidates for all offices give a speech, but we would like to recognize them, allow them to stand up, state their name and the office that they're running for. So. Start, let's see. I see Mansell, so let's start with Mansell.
Excuse me, I think I know probably, certainly the majority of the folks in the room. I am Mansell LaCord. I'm from, have been involved in the Fulton County Party for better part of a decade and a half, if not close to two. I am running for a state treasurer at the convention in Athens, and I very much appreciate your consideration and your vote.
My name is Nate Porter. I'm running for the second vice chairmanship. Really simple, because I know you don't want us to say a whole lot. I believe firmly that it's the responsibility of the Republican Party to elect Republicans, but I also firmly believe that it's the responsibility of the Republican Party to define what a Republican is and hold elected officials accountable to that definition. I'm appreciating your support at the convention coming up for second vice chairman. Thank you.
All right. Well, with that, I'm going to recommend...
Wait, I just got an email. Somebody just...
Oh, this is...
I don't know this person, but they're right.
We do have someone here, actually, who's running for State House in South Fulton. John Guest actually used to run a breakfast in South Fulton, very similar to what we do up here. He did a great job with that. I'm really bad at seeing out in the crowd. There you are, John. You want to stand up and introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm John Guest. A lot of you know me. And I just want to tell you that some people think I'm related to George Custer, but I'm not. I am running for Tyrone Brooks' former seat because this race is winnable. We've got a special election. We've only got 37 days. And if we band together, we can sneak up on them and corral them. I guarantee you we can. And as an example of that, Karen Handel did that in a special election. Mike Ken did that in the special election. If we can get 2,500 votes in the 55th state district, we can win it. And John has been a great help to me. We've got the state party, Trey, Fulton County party is helping me. I would like to invite all of you to help me because this is a winnable race and we can do it. It's kind of like my church asks you for help. I'd like your prayers, I'd like your presence, I'd like your gifts, and I would like your service, your volunteer. But thank you so much, and I've got a card, I've got a website, you can find me.
Thanks, John. Not an easy task, thank you for being willing to take a the charge. All right, so now I'm sure y'all want to know more about the state convention. So Alex Johnson, one of the candidates, is not able to be with us this morning, but he has sent a very delightful speaker, I'm sure, Mr. Jack Staper, who's going to come up here and tell you about their campaign.
Alex got himself double booked, so he asked me if I'd do this for him, and I was happy to do that. He gave me a statement to read, so I'm not making this up. This is from him. Alex cannot be here today, but he wanted me to tell you a little about his candidacy for Georgia GOP chair. Alex has been active Republican since being involved in the College Republicans and running for Georgia Senate in 2010 as a Republican nominee for District 41. Among other positions, he served as the legal counsel for DeKalb GOP and chairman of DeKalb County Young Republicans. He's also led and served within numerous other organizations. As a 30-year-old attorney, he has the energy, experience, and vision to build on our successes and make the party even stronger. Alex believes that in order to get Republicans elected, the state party must focus on growing and supporting strong statewide grassroots infrastructure that's targeted supporting county parties, not just a few favored and overpaid political consultants. We must maintain our Republican brand and grow the party in order to win the future. Alex has a plan to ensure the party is financially sustainable and raises money in order to defeat the Democrats in 2016. While the Georgia GOP had come close to $1 billion in the bank 2 years ago after presidential election, as of March 28, 2015, the Georgia GOP had less than $8,000 available for use. From January 1st to March 28th of this year, our cash flow was a negative $170,000. As a party, we keep raising and spending money for consultants without focusing on sustainable infrastructure and party involvement. Alex will work to grow the party and raise the money by providing a value to the public and a reason to be involved. Under his leadership, there will be more lower price fundraisers around the state. Lower expenses will get more people involved. The Georgia GOP will help provide political speakers to county parties in order to increase involvement. And most importantly, the Georgia GOP will focus year-round to send educational and informational materials to voters and let them know, number one, what the party stands for and how our platform helps their lives. Number two, how and why to get involved in the party. Number three, what is going on with our Republican politicians so the voters and the party have the knowledge necessary to hold them accountable and ensure that Republicans act like Republicans. And don't betray our big tent Republican principles once elected. Alex wants us all to work together to get Republicans elected and to keep Georgia red far into the future. By creating a system in Georgia where fundraising is used to educate voters, thereby growing the party and increasing involvement, which will in turn raise more and more money, Georgia can be the pinnacle of Republican involvement and principles in the nation. Please vote for Alex in Athens on May 16th. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact him at 404-436-1467 and check out his website at www.advancethegop.com. Thank you, Alex. And I have flyers over there if anybody's interested in flyers. If anybody has any questions, I can try to answer a question for you. He said I could do that.
What's his
That's
middle
his
name?
First mistake. His middle name, that one I can't answer. That's it. So, all right. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Most of y'all. John Padgett has been the leader of the Georgia Republican Party for the past 2 years. He is seeking re-election on his record of being undefeated in all statewide elections, and we're delighted to have Mr. Padgett with us this morning. Please give him a round of applause.
Anybody here from the press?
Yes.
You got the lady with the camera.
I'm finally to the age where I occasionally need to refer to notes if I've got a lot to say. So I've got some things to say. First of all, we are having a convention in Athens, Georgia. It technically starts at 2 o'clock on Friday of this week. And it will actually begin with some activities on Thursday. Athens is a little town. It's 60, 65 miles east of here. They play football there. It's a neat place to have a state convention because the majority of you have either been there while going to school or sent a kid or a grandkid to Athens. So you know a little bit about most of you. Those of you who went to Tech, it's about 65 miles, and we won't talk about last year's football. We will have on Thursday a state committee meeting and an executive committee meeting. And then we will, some that are in town on Thursday will be going to Gary Black's farm for a fish fry. And Senator Bill Cowser and I are hosting a party that's a private party at the convention center in the atrium. And any of you that are in town for the convention or around town and want to come to a nice party, you're more than welcome. Come and be associated with some great Republicans. We'd love to have you show up there for that. On Friday morning, there'll be some activities, including a breakfast that Brian Kemp is hosting that will include Governor Christie. And I can't exactly remember. I believe it starts at 8:30. Then during the day, there'll be some minority engagement programs. We'll gavel in the convention at 2 o'clock on Friday afternoon, about 3 o'clock, Senator Rubio will speak. We'll finish up the convention and call a halt to the activities about 4 o'clock. We'll also have some other speakers, including some of our congressional delegation. And then that night, there'll be some other activities. There'll be a party down at the, what I used to call the History Village Inn. I think it's called the Graduate now. The red, white, and boots party, and then prior to that, we'll have a banquet, and a guest speaker for the banquet will be Senator Ted Cruz. We expect several hundred people to be at that banquet. It ought to be a great event. And we'll gavel the convention back in at 10 o'clock on Saturday. We'll have some other speakers during the day, and during the day, we will complete the business of the convention, which will include the election of officers, talking about resolutions and rules. And then we hope we'll be out of there by about 4 or 4:30. That's the plan. It ought to be a great convention. Our original plan for the convention, and it still is, that it'd be a celebration of what we accomplished last year politically. It was a great year for Republicans. And when I'm talking about things that we did last year, be sure you understand that when I mean what you and the state party accomplished together. The state party, the mechanism, staff, that doesn't get the job done. We can't get the job done without you. And you were absolutely magnificent last year. I'll remind you that we won everything that we could win last year, including the little house race over here in Augusta. And we retired a guy named John Farrell. Some of you heard me say this before. He's originally from Athens. He was a politician in Athens. I've been trying to beat the guy for 30 years or so, and we finally got it.
in later about how you got it. It was a great plan, and we executed it really well. Well, let me talk about some things that we did as a party last year, we being all of us. First of all, we came out of that convention last year. How many of you were there? Okay. How many of you are going to be new to the convention this year? All right. Well, last year, if you remember, we had just lost a presidential election to a guy named Obama. We were there at the convention. I don't think anybody was really happy. There was a lot of finger pointing going on, both inside the state and nationally, about how we lost that election. And we left that convention, actually, without finishing the convention. We didn't finish the work we had to do on resolutions. So when I got the job, one of the first things that I had to do was to finish that job. So we had a state committee meeting down in Milledgeville. A couple of things happened at that meeting that I think were significant in our success last year. First of all, the state committee is about 150 folks. And everybody on that state committee does not always agree with everybody else, and certainly everybody didn't agree with all the resolutions. And probably some people left and they didn't get their way, or they weren't happy with the way the vote on the resolution was. But what they left with was this. They knew that Jon Padgett and the state party would allow anybody to speak, anybody to voice their opinions. We gave them plenty of time to do that. And I'm pretty sure that everybody left there pretty happy with the way we ran that convention. Now, prior to that, right after the election, the convention, I had a meeting with my staff and the newly elected officers, and here are a couple of things we talked about. One was that we had to be sure when we got to the election of last year that everybody in the state that was a Republican, no matter what faction of the party they were, whether they were Liberty or one of any of the Tea Party groups, or they were Christian Republicans, or they were right down the middle, moderate Republicans, whatever they were welcome in the party. Come in the party. If you had some ideas about rules, bring your ideas about rules. If you have some ideas about candidates, bring your candidates. If you didn't like the folks we had representing us, go on out. I went all over the state, said it countless times. If you don't like them, throw them out. So, when we got to the election of this last year, what happened? We all went and voted. It was a great success. Because we started that success by going all over the state. I made between my election and the election of last year approximately 300 appearances around the state. I got a car out there. I wrecked my car almost 2 years ago. 2 years ago in July, that car's got 80,000 miles on it and I bought it brand new. I've been all over this state. It's a big old state. But we had messages to take to you, and that's what we did. I talked to this group more than once. All right, during the year, or a year and a half, or 2 years since we've been in office, we've had 15 foundation events. They've been all over the state. They haven't been just here in Atlanta. We took them all over the state. We had constant contact with county and district chairs. Those of you that are county and district chairs or have served in that capacity in the last year or so will realize and remember we were in constant contact with you throughout the last couple of years. We established a speaker's bureau, so if you wanted to have a speaker, all you had to do is call the state office and we'd help arrange a speaker for you. We had 2 to 4 emails and press releases each week. And why was that important? Because we're trying to build a point. Number one, we could have just not, and we used some consultants sometimes to do that. We could have just sat over there on Maple and not communicated with you or the press or Republicans around the state, but that's not what we did. We were out there. Sometimes some of the emails and press releases were not very well received by the Democrats. We had 4 major banquets. We established a committee system. A couple of those were great successes. One led by Mike McNeely, Community Development. We raised money, you raised money around the state to fund a program that allowed parents to have a place to live while their kids were being treated for any number of different illnesses in Atlanta. Great program. And then we had a VA program managed by Ron Johnson. And what their project was to buy sports wheelchairs for veterans that were crippled up from the war. Great program. Give you one little example of how great the program was. We had a lady major that had some crippling effects from the war down in Augusta. We were going to give her a wheelchair. And by the way, the company makes these wheelchairs here in Georgia. It's pretty special. If you want to play rugby, they got a wheelchair for playing rugby. If you want to play basketball, they got a wheelchair for basketball. And they fit in these wheelchairs. This is a great company. So this lady called us. We were going to have an award ceremony and get a little good press, we thought, out of it. And she called Ron and she says, listen, there's a veteran down here that just came back from Afghanistan. He's not crippled, but he has a son. He's got a son, somewhere along the line, 7 or 8 years old, had this terribly debilitating disease, and it was extremely painful in his feet. And he asked the doctor to cut his feet. That's tough to get, folks. That's tough to get. The lady major wanted to give the kid a surgery. So we bought them both. It was an emotional day. Got in that wheelchair. We had that. It just happened to be. We had the ceremony in a gym and took that basketball and rolled that wheelchair down and made the first shot out of that wheelchair. I thought, man, this is what Republican is really all about. This is what it's really all about. So thank you all those of you that contributed to you. We had about 25 counties in Georgia when I got this job that weren't organized. A lot of counties. I said, just in case you want to go back and look, that I was going to get them all organized by the convention this year. Well, it didn't make it. Well, we organized 13. We got two or three more that are in the work. We'll get them all organized. It may just take us another couple of years. What's the importance of organizing these counties? Growing the party, folks. It's growing the party. When you organize a county, you turn out more votes, you turn out more Republicans, and in a statewide race, every vote counts. That's why you do it. And that's why we spent the money and the time and the effort in organizing those counties. We organized, by the way, 10 new chapters of Georgia College Republic. Pretty special. Including a chapter at Morehouse University. We organized 8 minority engagement organizations. We doubled the black Republican vote in the state of Georgia this last election. Effect of 9 new chapters of College Republicans, 8 minority engagement organizations, and doubling that vote, we expanded the party. That's what we're about. We brought more people into the party than probably we ever had in a 2-year period before. We increased the number of young Republican clubs. We increased the number of teen Republican clubs. We managed 7 Senate debates all over this state, not just here in Atlanta. All over the state. And by the way, if you can remember back to the primaries of last year for the governorship, the Senate race, 4 House seats, and the state superintendent race, we had about 45 candidates, 45 Republican candidates. Now, what did that mean to the state party? It meant there were 45 campaigns out there and 45 groups raising money. And folks, they soaked up the money. And then we got through with that, and what did we have then? Runoffs that lasted forever. Oh, good Lord, if we ever get through this, I'm going to go spend some more time in Nashville. No, had a runoff. So if we had a runoff, what did we get into? General election. The state party, with all that going on, raised about $6.5 million that we spent to elect Republican candidates. Now let me ask you a really simple question, I think. We'll see. What's the job of the state Republican Party? What's somebody say?
To elect Republicans.
To elect Republicans. It's not for me to go out and pontificate about what I think we're supposed to be doing as a Republican Party.
is to elect Republicans.
Right.
Folks, you and the state Republican Party, elected the hell out of Republicans last year.
Goodness gracious.
Now, we got towards the end of the campaign last year. I remember back what was going on nationally, what we were doing here in this state. And what were you hearing from the pundits nationally? What were you hearing from bloggers? And actually, what were we hearing from some of our own folks in Washington about the races? So this is what we heard. David Perdue's going to get in a runoff. The governor might get in a runoff, and you don't have a chance to beat John Barrow down there in Augusta.
Yep.
That's what we've been told. So, what's the job of the Republican Party in the state of Georgia? Get folks elected. So, let's say I got $1 million in the bank the day before the election. And we get in two runoffs and we lose the race down in Augusta. And I can say, wait a minute, I got $1 million in the bank. That's really good. You throw me out before Thanksgiving. The job of the party is to spend the money that you have contributed and win races. So that's what we did. Did we have a runoff? No. Did we elect David Perdue?
Yes. Yes.
Did we beat John Barrow? Yeah.
Yes.
Did we elect all of the down ticket folks? Yeah. Did we win five races over on the Gold Dome that maybe we weren't supposed to win? Yeah. We did all that because we managed our money well. Now, we get to this year. Are we supposed to have a lot of money in the bank in an off year? No, that's not what we're doing. If we had $3 million in the bank right now, sitting in the bank right now, the folks that contributed to the party want to know, what are you doing? You got my money tied up over there. What are you doing, earning interest on? There's no campaigns going on. Our job this year is to raise only enough money to keep the party's bills paid. We'll raise $6 or $7 million next year when we get into the race to beat Barack Obama and elect a United States Senator, folks. I'll tell you that right now. And by the way, while we were doing all that, we had a great relationship with the RNC, the House Committee, the Senate Committee, the Governor's Association. A great relationship. And you can't win. Folks, let me tell you. If you didn't recognize what was going on last year, that's big boy politics. That's as big as it gets. It was huge politics. At one time, they were saying, if we don't win David Perdue's seat, we're not going to win the Senate. It was big politics. Bajillions of dollars spent in this state last year. And we won. Now, what else did we do as a party to win? Well, first of all, down in Augusta, and I think this should be kind of interesting to you, at Augusta, we started knocking on doors as part of our victory program in November before the November election. We got to within 2 weeks of that election of John Barrow, he was beat. He started buying people to start knocking on doors. Now, what did we do that was different, by the way? Well, for one thing, we had a great telephone system for folks to make phone calls. And by the way, we had a great way to knock on doors with a new telephone app. Any of you tried that last year? Pretty good little app. It allowed a couple of things. It allowed us to go call on people, not like Bob Shaw. Heck, we knew he was going to vote Republican. But in the past, if you knocked on doors, what'd you have? You had a piece of paper with folks like Bob Shaw on the piece of paper, and that's who you called on. You got to be sure and go vote. That's not what we did. That wasn't our plan. In fact, I was hoping it was going to work. And it did. We called on low propensity voters. That's voters that normally didn't vote in an off-year election. Or voters that only voted 1 in 5 times, let's say, in a Republican primary. And what did we accomplish? 213,000 low propensity voters went to the polls and voted with us, and what did we win the election by? 200,000 votes. Ladies and gentlemen, that program is what won the elections. Not all the money we spent in clicky ads. We turned out the vote. And by the way, what else did we do when we did that? We expanded the party. We got people energized to be part of what we're doing that typically maybe would show up every 4, 5, 6 years. We had 17 field offices. You know we had that. We had two in Augusta. We had over 1,000 grassroots volunteers that were leaders in what we were doing, and another 1,000 that were leaders, and another 5,000 that were volunteers. You made, because of our program, you made 1.6 million voter contacts. Is that expanding the party and working towards expanding the party? You bet. We made 1.2 million telephone calls. We made 400,000 door knocks. The last week of the election, the last week, we made 400,000 contacts. The day before the election, folks, we made 87,000 contacts. Now, folks, that's a political program that's going to work. And when we get to next year, then we're going to do the same thing. If you elect me again, if you don't elect me again, I don't know what we're going to do. But we know that next year, that's what we're going to do. We've already got the plan in place. And we're going to spend the rest of this year, by the way, registering people to vote. That's our biggest program for this year, is to register as many new Republicans as we can. And I don't know whether you remember back when I was running for this office, but everybody that was running talking about it. Got to increase our social media presence. Got to do something with social media. Social media. Well, if you don't know, I'm almost 70 years old. But I love Facebook. I'm not too good on tweeting, but I love Facebook. When I got this job, we had 8,000 Facebook likes. 8,000. We got 115,000 Facebook likes now. It's the second largest number of Facebook likes on a state political page, either Democrat or Republican, in the country, second only to Wisconsin. I thought that was pretty special, but we can get now. We had a little Facebook post on my little iPad about that year, and it was something about, I don't remember, it was something about Obama. A month or so. We had 10 or 12,000 likes. That thing got shared over 1 million computer posts. Now that's getting some word out on social media.
John, we're getting a little closer.
I know you are. Okay.
I hate being that guy.
I know, but I'm in charge.
That is a bulldog. I let people do that.
I am running again. I appreciate your vote and support. It's going to be a great 2 years. We're going to be so happy when we get to the end of this next 2 years and we don't have Obama or Hillary again. And it's going to be because of you. God bless y'all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John.
That guy to interrupt the chairman. I will regret that, and we have it chronicled stone forever. Anyway, John was mentioning the great victory we just had, and a couple people came in today and mentioned that I still have my Nathan Deal bumper sticker on my car, which I do. So I have a little rule. Every time I see a Jason Carter or Michelle Nunn bumper sticker, I leave it on for another 2 months. So I live in DeKalb County, so that sucker's going to be on for a long time. Now, I don't know if you guys are keeping score, but I was. State of Texas 2, ISIS 0. Yeah. I was thinking that they were so successful in Texas, they should start running adventure tourism ads in ISIS-controlled territory. They can have like one-way tickets from Southwest Airlines with the slogan, "Y'all come back now, you hear?" In fact, ISIS now says they have 71 fighters ready to attack the United States. Just a little bit of math. I'm in the mortgage business. I'm pretty good at it. That means Allah needs to start prepping 5,112 virgins. They had a really
really busy week of candidate announcements this past week, didn't we? We had Carly Fiorina for Vice President, Ben Carson for Surgeon General, and Mike Huckabee for Chaplain. So a lot of folks. My dream ticket, though, guys, is Senator Isaacson and Governor Scott Walker. Can you imagine Johnny Walker 2016? We'll help you forget the last 8 years. And on a final note, folks, everybody ready for Hillary? I hope.
Ready for what?
I'm ready for her to turn over her emails.
Yeah.
And her server. And all the other information. People that support her and her husband says it's all a big witch hunt. Now, we know that's a bunch of malarkey, folks, but if it was a witch hunt, this would be the first one in history that actually produced a witch. Anyway, thank you guys. I can't wait to see everybody. I'll be broadcasting my show, Greg's List, live from Athens, Georgia. I'm on Tuesdays from 2 to 3 p.m. Blogs at gregslistlive.blog.com. Great to see everybody here, and great to see you guys in Athens next week, home of the Georgia Bulldogs and Mr. Patrick. So thank you guys. I tested most of those on Facebook earlier.
Our next speaker is Representative Chuck Martin. Representative Martin actually spoke to us, I think, at our last two breakfasts. So he's been really great in coming out to these meetings and interacting. And those were up in his part of the county in North Fulton. He lives in Alhambra. He came down to join us this morning in Sandy Springs and tell y'all about some stuff going on at the state capitol. He's actually running for House Majority Leader, so he's going to talk about his campaign and maybe answer some questions about the session if anybody has something that are unanswered.
Angela, thank you. I know we're running late and it's Saturday afternoon and folks have to leave. I absolutely understand. I want to thank you again for having the time to come out here on a Saturday morning. That's the difference that we have in this country, in this state, that we get to do that, and then people that are very busy and have families and businesses, you know, takes the time to do that, so thank you. And something else we hadn't done this morning, you know, all you guys, Greg, you know, and I guess it's always been near and dear to me, but especially this year, Sunday's Mother's Day. So everybody that's a mom, stand up in the room. Moms? All right, now everybody has got a mom. I'm serious, because you know you wouldn't be here. You wouldn't be here without mom. But moms do great things for us. I've always known that. I've always been anchored in my family. I lost my dad when I was 20 years old. He's 47, and for the longest time, when I approached that day of when I was going to be the exact age that he passed away, I'm not going to lie to you. I was scared. You just have that weird feeling about you. My mom went through a lot of stuff over the last 5 years. She was really sick in November and December. And I spent a lot of nights sleeping on her couch. She was at home. She you know, could get around, but she was not stable because she was so weak from not being able to eat. I don't know why I'm telling you all this about this morning. That's how we came for. But it's what drives me, because of all the sacrifices and things she did. And those were great days we spent. On Christmas Day, she got to come over to our house. First time she'd been out of the house in probably 45 days. And it was just like a light came on. Our two sons were there, John and I, and you know, the family. And it's like something changed, you know, on Christmas Day. And by December 31st, she could stay by herself, you know, again. And she got well and better. I talked to her on the 10th of February and was going home. I got stuck at the Capitol in a sales and use tax subcommittee meeting. Supposed to go home. Called her on the way out of Atlanta. And I made it that way. She said, I'm a little tired. Why don't you just wait and come home tomorrow? You got things to do down there. You need to, you know, do them. You need to come down there to do that. And then I got a call at 3 o'clock in the morning that she passed away. So this is the first Mother's Day without her, and I'm serious when I say that to you. It's important to be here. It's important for all the things that Chairman Padgett talked about in politics, but none of that makes a damn bit of difference.
if we don't have our family to count on and our family that we can believe in, you know, both personally, business, and politically. And that's one of the things that has driven me. So moms, I mean that. Thank you with all my heart for what you do, not only for your kids, but most moms do it for everybody else. I firmly believe that. And on a separate note, I'm having grand twins in September too, by the way, so I'm going to get to trial. I'm doing that. I've got another mom coming to our house. I want to talk about the leaders race really quick, and I know we're running late, and I want to tell you why about that. And I'm not politic, and I think there's maybe only one person in the room here that can vote for me, but I want to talk about that. But before I do, somebody asked a question about 170. I didn't spin my hand around about the Transportation Funding Act. I want to talk about this and that bill in terms of what I did, and you know, the number of people are very happy that passed. I'm very happy we have additional money for transportation. I'm not at all happy that we didn't take some of the money we were already taking for you and put in there first. My deal was, is if I have a deal and I have a business that I need $300 to do, or $400, I'll use you three people there, and I come to y'all and I pitch my business plan. If I need $400 to do this, can y'all give me $333 a piece? You're gonna look at me funny. If I throw my $100 on the table first, you're more apt to be part of the plan. I wanted to see us as a state put our money in first. And that's the reason I was never able to vote for that. Now, I'm gonna talk about later in these remarks why that's what happened and that's where we're going, and we need to go forward and not dwell on it. But I bring it up to say this. I don't know if Rusty had to leave or not, I don't see him out there. But Rusty said that, you know, Mayor Paul, he said about building the road 10 years if it takes federal laws. Here's how you fix that. You get rid of the darn federal gas tax and let the states keep their own darn money. You know, if we don't have to worry about the feds. So, I mean, we put ourselves and my colleagues at the state in a bad situation. We had to fix it because the federal government has it broken. And one of our guys, one of my former colleagues that we sent up from North Georgia up there, Tom Graves, has the bill to fix that, and he has a lot of good support with that bill. So let me fast forward and say this. About the Republican brand and what Republicans are, here's the reason I'm running for a leader. I've been in here 13 years. When I got in here 13 years ago, there were 71 of us. When the Democrats redistricted it was a mess. I mean, to gerrymander it and keep it, they had four-person districts. And I mean, y'all know the deal. Supreme Court turned those over, threw them out, Special Master had to draw. We 71 Republicans signed a letter that we were going to hang together or hang apart. We were not going to let the Democrats pick us off and you know, get a plan that was gerrymandered, except it would kind of pass. And we stood together, and we did that, and we got districts we could run on the next year. And we went from 71 members to over 90 members, Republican members in the House. Shortly after that, we had some of our friends from the other side come and join us, and we got up in the high 90s. And then an election later, we got over 100, and a couple more people came to join us. Now we're at 119. When Leader O'Neill announced his resignation, I wanted to run for the leader's position, not necessarily because I thought I could win, because two people had already been in it for 2 weeks. They knew before I did. And they're good people. I sit next to one of them and know the other one for the last 9 years. But I wanted to win to talk about this. Y'all remember Hal Moore? Y'all remember Colonel Hal Moore? We were soldiers? Look up. He actually retires, I think, a three-star general. But look up Colonel Moore. I've got the list of all of his leadership actions that he used. But three of them are very important that I think we should use with our caucus, that we could do a better job. Everyone is important to the mission from top to bottom. Everyone is important to the mission from top to bottom. Never deprive anyone of their self-respect. We have a bad problem in politics. If we don't agree with somebody, making them feel bad about themselves and an idea, that's not a good thing. We're really bad about that as Republicans sometimes.
talk about that briefly later. And to do well in a mission, you need to work with good people. Not have good people work for you, not boss them around, but you need to work with good people. Now, I wanted to take that forward and have that conversation. And I'm not saying anybody in our current leadership is doing it wrong. Everybody takes things on a different way. But I think there's a place, we work really hard, if I can use the farming analogy, that at 71 acres, we didn't have enough to feed everybody. 71 members, you know? And then we got to 90 and we needed a few more acres, and now we're at 119. We've got enough acres, you know, almost a constitutional market. We should be able to feed everybody. Except we're not farming the acreage. We're not using everybody to their maximum potential. Now, part of that is because you hear when you come in the house, you know, just sit and learn for 2 years or 4 years or three. I mean, there's something to be said that. I mean, Rich Golick over in judiciary knows a heck of a lot more about the law than Chuck Martin does, and I've been down there 13 years. But he knows things that I don't know. But there are new minds that have come into our house in the last, you know, 3-4 years that can really add to things. But sometimes when they have an idea, it's not as taken as seriously because they're new. You know, the 54,000 plus people sent them down there just like they sent me from the 49th. They're every bit as important to the state of Georgia as I am. So I want to see us as a caucus. We're the largest group of Republicans in the state. No disrespect to my friends over in the Senate, Leader Cowser and the crew over there, but they have a 38 of them. We have 119. We come from all over the state of Georgia. We have farmers and lawyers and doctors. We may not have a doctor anymore. We actually sent Dr. Watson over to the Senate. But we have a lot of people from a lot of different areas. So I want to see us pull those people together. And I think I can do that as a majority leader. And my pledge to you is, regardless of what happens on Monday, I'm going to do that as the representative from the 49th. Not to detract away from the governor, or the lieutenant governor, or the speaker, or the pro tem, or whoever wins the leader's position. But it's just dawned on me of late that I believe, and tell me if you think I'm wrong, but I believe we tend to kill our success as Republicans when we do this. When I've had so many people, when they come up with an issue, and they find somebody that doesn't agree with them or it doesn't get to the House floor, they run to a reporter and go, that guy is not a Republican because I want X, Y, and Z. And they won't let me have my bill, and therefore he's not a Republican. Well, I got news for you people. Nobody in this room, with due respect to you, Chairman Schwall, if anybody in this room can own a Republican, you're probably the man that can do it. But not even you, I believe, can own the Republican brand. It belongs to everybody that wants to grasp it. It probably belongs more to a guy like Harry Geisinger than it does to anybody in this room. Harry Geisinger fought for years. Whether you agree with this or not, he fought for years to get horse racing and parimutuel betting. Not one time when that didn't come to the floor did Harry go run to Channel 2 or 5 or 11 and say, you know, that person, you know, that committee is not a Republican. They wouldn't let me have my bill on the floor. You know what Harry did? He kept making his case. He kept making his case. So if you're brand new to the party, or if you've been in here as long as Harry had, or Chairman Schwall, if you make your case, don't call names. We tend to do that. We hide behind things on social media. Make your case for things. And I think I as a caucus member now, regardless of my position, I'm going to reach out to people and encourage them to make their case, not feel disenfranchised, if you will, not feel a loss of self-respect, but say your piece and do it. And I think we've got to do that. If we fail to do that, we continue to go around and look at a pox on everybody and find a reason that I can't agree with you instead of all the reasons we can. And that's what the other guys want. That's what the other party wants to do. They want to stick something in between us and have us fuss amongst ourselves and not focus on winning the end game. And I would say this, there shouldn't be fussing, but there should be active, lively, and sometimes high-volume debate on something. I'm not bothered by that.
So I would say this. I always ask, and I'll be done here and answer a question if you have time. When I was coaching little guys, I was fortunate enough to get coached with a guy named Craig Ramsey. I don't know if you guys know Craig Ramsey. I think he still runs a big version, a big portion of Accenture here. You might remember little Craig Ramsey. He was might have been the Golden Spikes winner in 2012 out of Florida State. He's first round draft pick of St. Louis. But Coach Ramsey and I, Craig my age, coached those guys and my son. A number of them went on to play college baseball, and some still in the pros. But Craig, at 6 years old, Craig would take those guys, and I learned this from Craig. At the end of every day, practice or game, he asked those six-year-olds, what we did well, what we didn't do well, and what can we get better at? And I think we've got to ask ourselves as Republicans around the state, as Republicans in our caucus, those three things, because we tend to get together. And this is what, you know, welcome to the precedent room. I'm going to say it because I've said it before and I'll say it again. We tend to get together sometimes as Republicans and just want to feel good about ourselves and have, you know, a mutual admiration, talk about all the good things we do. And we do a lot of good things, but there's things we need to get better at. So that's my challenge, and that's what I want to do. We've gotten better in Washington, D.C. Our caucus, I think they call it, Councilman, they call it the conference in Washington, right? Not the caucus, the Republican conference. The Republican conference is doing a better job, I think, in the last 6 or 8 months with some of the new leadership chairs of letting people have their say. And you know, if you can't make your point, then you move on. But we need to do a better job of that. So that's what I want to do. I want to look at what we did well, what we didn't do so well, and what we can get better at. And a perfect example of that, and I'm, you know, don't mean to be crossways with some of my leadership or my governor, but I think you could take House Bill 170 as a perfect example of that. We did that well because we got some transportation funding. In my opinion, we didn't debate it as well as we could have because we, at the last minute, threw that hotel tax on and nobody had talked about it. That wasn't really good. I'm going to say that right in front of everybody. I don't believe that was a good thing. So we got transportation. We did that well. We didn't have the kind of debate I think we should have and look at money we were already getting. So what can we get better at? We can have a more open, honest, and full discussion on things like that. Because if we do that, 119 Republicans in the House can get it right, and we can do that. So with that, thank you. I hope, you know, I didn't spend too much time or leave you with a downer, because I'm excited about what we have the opportunity to do, but I think we have to do those things. We can get better. If we don't want to get better, then we're just taking up space. We can't rest on our laurels. So we've got a lot of hardworking people. I appreciate you guys being here. Again, Moms, thanks for doing everything you do for us. It's a great opportunity to get to represent the 49th District. And I wish Mayor Paul was here. I'd compare economic development, you know, to city center, to everything with my city up there. Love it to death. If we got time, I'll take a question too. I know we're getting to the end of the day. Yes, sir.
So, I understand that the vote Monday is going to be secret ballot. Is that correct?
That's the caucus rules allow that. Yes, sir.
Good. Yes, sir. That's a plus.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, can you give us your personal definition of what a Republican is and why you use that label?
That's a great question. And I'm going to say, I think maybe, did you post the thing on the internet the other day? I may have gotten your post about, do you think the party is to determine what a Republican
is?
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah, I think the Republican, you know, is about freedom. It's about, it's hard for me to put into words what I think Republicanism is. To me, it is allowing people to have freedom of choice. But I'll tell you where I think we have the problems when I give you my definition of it, is you'll take, I don't think Republicans' issues are black and white. I think issues of lower taxes is black and white. I'll say this, and you know, we have camera running. I never signed Grover Norquist's no tax pledge. You know, some people will tell you, if you don't do that, you're not a Republican. I respectfully disagree. But go find a place down there where I voted for, you know, what I consider to be more taxes. So, you know, I consider a Republican to be somebody that wants to put the freedoms of our country, you know, the Constitution, in front of the popular thing of the day. I think it changes from time to time. I'll get in trouble when I say this, but when people defend, you know, all the freedom of carry, and I have a carry permit, right? But when people want to do this and say, well, the Constitution says you have the right to bear arms. Well,
technically, if you go to that, then, I mean, an M1A1 tank is an arm. Do you think everybody should, you know, does the Constitution allow you to do that? I think there's always some interpretation in that. I mean, I it makes sense to me to let people have some latitude and still be part of the larger town. I don't think, I'm pro-life. Okay. I know a lot of Republicans that claim to be pro-choice. I'm not going to say you're not a Republican because you're not pro-life like I am. I'm not going to call somebody not a Republican because they voted for House Bill 170 and I thought it was a tax increase that we didn't have to have right now. So does that make sense to you? I mean, you probably want a you probably want a more textbook definition. I think Republicanism to me is looking at each individual thing and saying, does it create more freedom? You know, is it constitutional? You know, I can give you a list that you've heard before, but in my mind, I look at bills and try to make sure that they don't limit, you know, people's ability to live in this country under the Constitution. Yes, ma'am.
So I know that you don't want to put a real definitive definition around what a Republican is. But can you say how the Republicans are different than the Democrats? Because that's what I think a lot of people today struggle with.
No, I mean, in my mind, it's about what they believe government should do for you. I mean, that's the biggest thing that I think. I have some colleagues down at the House I really like. But we just differ because they think government should take all the money and hand it out to the, you know, people in certain programs. And decide what those are. And so if I look at it right now, the fiscal nature at the state and federal level are what scares me most about the dichotomy between the Republicans and the Democrats. I think that is a big thing. They want to control things. Here's what I would say about this. Every dollar at the state capitol in Washington has a constituency. Every dollar has a constituency. And every Republican you ever elect wants to cut taxes and have less spending until they're the person that gets to decide how to spend it. Mm-hmm. And then you have to really, you have to be in a position to decide how to spend it and see somebody that wants to cut, you know, the spending to do it. And that's the struggle we have. But I think it's government's involvement in our life is a big difference between the Democrats and the Republicans. I mean, there are people that want to take more money. I see it, Georgia. I know. The Georgia Budget and Policy Institute. The guy used to run it. He retired. Alan Essex used to run it. Alan's a great guy. He's a numbers guy. But every time you come out with something, if there's a cut, it's as if the government's taking something away from people. It's not the government's job to make sure everybody has a cell phone. I understand that might be happy, healthy, and that's what I don't mean to not get to your answer to me. But it's almost like you bring up individual points of issue, and I'll tell you what I think, you know, on that, and you can grade me accordingly rather than me give you this definition of what it is. I mean, go look back at my record and the way I voted. I think that it is Republican ideals. So, yes, ma'am. We have one more?
I don't think so.
Okay.
If you want one more question, raise your hand. Okay.
That's democracy.
Everybody understands. There we go.
Well, Chuck, thank you so much. And I'm so glad.
On June 18th and 20th, You won't have many chances to see all 15, 20, 100 candidates that we have running together in one place like you will in D.C. next month. We'll have debates around the country unless you give $2,000 to each debate or get a rare ticket. You won't have to see them all and meet them all as well, not even at the GOP convention next weekend. So see me afterwards. We'd love to have you. It's only $60 for the conference. We have buses going up from Georgia that are at a very good rate, and the hotels are pretty affordable as well. So again, my name's Robert Potts, Road to Majority 2015 for Faith and Freedom Coalition. Would love to have you join us. Thank you.
Wanted to recognize a couple of other people. Bill Nevins over here runs the Midtown Breakfast, which is one of our partner events. It's the third Thursday of the month. It's really early. It's like 7:30, so y'all can get to work. And that's an Empire State South. Bill confessed to me this was the first time he'd been north of 285 for a full GOP event.
Welcome, OTP.
Jack Winter over here is also a former chairman of the Fulton County Republican Party, and he has worked incredibly hard behind the scenes. He doesn't like the limelight too much, but he deserves a lot of credit for making things happen. At my table over here, you can't really see him, but Mark Smith works for Senator David Perdue, so I just wanted to let y'all know that his office is represented here. Thank you. Afterwards, and let's see, there's so many people to thank, but thank you to Slopes Barbecue. Thank you to Suzi, Voyles, and Charlie Wingo. Charlie said to mention, by the way, if anyone wants a receipt for breakfast, you can come see him and he'll give you one. Thank you to Trey Kelly, who's doing a great job as our new chairman. And thank you to Jon Richards, our unofficial photographer from Gwinnett County, who comes here sometimes. And most importantly, thank you to all of you for coming out here and spending your Saturday with us, and we hope you will come back many more times.